Our scripture this morning is from Mark 12, 13 through 17, and also Mark 12, 41 through 44. Later they sent some of the Pharisees and Herodians to Jesus to catch him in his words. They came to him and said, "Teacher, we know you are a man of integrity. You aren't swayed by men because you pay no attention to who they are, but you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay or shouldn't we?" But Jesus knew their hypocrisy. "Why are you trying to trap me?" he asked. "Bring me a denarius and let me look at it." They brought the coin, and he asked them, "Whose portrait is this? And whose inscription?" "Caesar's," they replied. Then Jesus said to them, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's." And they were amazed at him. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts. But a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a fraction of a penny. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "I tell you the truth, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all that she had to live on."
The word of the Lord. Amen. Children are dismissed if you'd like to head out to Children's Church. Let's rearrange. Now, we have been talking for the last several weeks about this moment, right? That moment for treasure. When we get to stand before Jesus Christ and say, "Lord, with pride, this is what I invested my life in, these people, your kingdom." And being able to stand before him and say, "This was going to last for all of eternity." So it seems fitting that as we're talking about the moment of our treasure, that we would be in Mark and we would be looking at the day when Jesus stood in the treasury in the temple. So set the scene. Let's think about this for a second. What we are told, see, I have to turn it on. We're off to an auspicious beginning. Here we go. Jesus is standing in the treasury, which would have been in the court of women. The court of women was accessible to every male, every female, young and old. Every Jewish individual could stand and come into the court. They couldn't go into the court of men, and they certainly couldn't go into the court where the priests go, near to the Holy of Holies. But this was as close as everybody could get to be able to come into the presence of God and worship him there. And the Mishnah, which is a really, really old Jewish text, was written by rabbis after the destruction of the temple when they said, "Well, let's remember what it was like." The Mishnah tells us that in the court of women, there's these 13 trumpet-shaped bowls, right? Think like a trumpet inverted with the bell at the top. 13 of them there in the court of women, each one for a different thing. Think like really early version of designating your offering, okay? And a priest would stand there. And part of the priest's job was to help you, to say, "You're here today, you want to worship the Lord in this way, you want to thank God for this thing, so your offering goes in that bowl." But the other part of the priest's job at that moment was to make sure that if you gave a significant amount, everybody there got to know. It would be like if I stood next to the offering plates and I opened your envelopes, and as you were leaving, I said, "Jeff's giving 500 today. Woohoo!" Hint. Right? They literally would stand there and announce how much was being given. And if the priest was off duty or slacking, it didn't really matter, because you see, there was a reason why those receptacles were shaped the way they were. It was because when you took your money and you threw it into the metal receptacle, well, it sort of sounded like Vegas on jackpot, right? You can hear it everywhere. And so Jesus is sitting there. He's in the court of women. He's watching, honestly, he's watching the show. And what Mark says is that Jesus sees the rich come and throw their money in. Because if you throw it in nice and loud, in an era before there's cash or checks or Venmo, everybody hears how much you're giving or not giving. And Jesus says all of these folks come, he sees the rich people, and they're just throwing the money. They're just chucking it in, making sure you know how much they gave. But along comes a poor widow. And she's poor, I presume, Jesus can tell because he can look at her. And he can tell by the way that she's dressed that she doesn't have a whole lot. Where I come from, we would say she didn't have two nickels to rub together. That means poor, okay? And she must have been dressed in the clothes of a mourner, someone who is grieving the loss of a loved one. And so Jesus looks and says, here is a very poor widow, meaning she has no one and she has nothing. And we're told that the rich have just been chucking their money in. But here comes this poor widow, and all she has is two lepta. Now, my last congregation had a guy who collected coins, and one day he showed up with those itty-bitty things, and he says, preacher, I found lepta at the whatever coin exchange one goes to. I don't get to show these off very often, so you're going to look at a giant picture of them, okay? Just saying. Lepta was the tiniest currency, denomination of currency in Rome. They're itty-bitty little bronze things. I mean, you can see that's compared to a penny, okay? A penny. And they're tinier than that. Today's economy, each lepta is the equivalent of about 1/8 of a penny, okay? So if she's offering 2 lepta, she is offering 1/4 of a cent. That's all she has. In her world, in that era, a lepta, each one would be about the rough equivalent of 5 minutes of your workday, right? 5 minutes worth of wages. That's it. That's all this lady's got. And she's got 2 of them. And Jesus says he's standing there and he watches her take her 2, not 1, but 2, and put them both in. I guarantee you no priest stood and announced that. Nothing in the temple was going to be dedicated with her name on it. And honestly, the story should have ended there. Like, her story should be finished. She came, she gave her 2 lepta, gave her offering to the Lord, and she left. And it would have finished there, right? We would have been done. Nobody knew, nobody remembered, honestly, nobody cared. Except that the King of Kings was watching. That Jesus saw what took place. And when Jesus watched this, he says, this is a teaching moment. So he calls all the disciples over. And I want you to catch what he says. See, Jesus does not bring the disciples to him and say, I want you to see the inequity in this world. Look at how there's someone so rich and people so poor. That shouldn't be that way. Now, Jesus says that elsewhere. But that's not what he teaches in that moment. Nor does he bring them over and say, guys, when you give, don't do it like those folks just did, making some big show of it. Do it like the widow did, nice and quiet. Jesus will teach that. And we talked about it this morning in Sunday school class, as a matter of fact. But that's not the comparison he makes here. He brings those disciples over and he says, look, because what I'm about to tell you is incredibly significant. So much so, he begins the sentence by saying, amen. Now, we have talked about that in here before. You and I, we can only put amen at the end of things, right? I listen to your prayer or I listen to you say something, and if I agree with you and I kind of want it to happen, I say amen. And if you say something and I'm like, that's off the wall, I just stay quiet. Jesus is the only person who gets to start the sentence that way. When he begins a sentence with amen, it is Jesus' way of saying, what I'm about to say, you can disagree with and you will just be wrong. It's true. So Jesus starts the sentence off and he says, amen. This poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. The lady that gave that. See, they all gave out of their wealth. They gave out of their margin. They gave out of their excess. They gave their leftovers. But she, out of her poverty, put in everything. And then the Greek literally says, her whole life. That's the comparison Jesus makes that day. He brings the disciples over and he says, there were two worshipers up front. Catch that. Because Jesus is not saying, hey, I think the widow really, really loves the Lord and the rich people doesn't. He's not questioning their faithfulness. He's not questioning their integrity. He says there's a difference between two worshipers happening up there. One of them is worshiping out of excess, giving leftovers. Doesn't feel it, doesn't hurt. The other one gave everything. She gave her life. And those are two radically different ways for you and I to present ourselves before our God. And I think maybe it's worth thinking about that a little bit more. Because if I had to ask the question of not you, but me, am I giving of my time? Am I giving of my skills? Am I giving of my money? Am I giving of me to my king out of my excess? So I'm just giving him leftovers. Or am I giving him my everything, my whole life? I think most of the time my answer is the first one. And my guess is that for most of us that's true. So let's think about this for a second. Let's say that this snazzy container here, filled with marbles, is your time. As a matter of fact, it is every hour that you have in the course of 7 days. You know how many hours there are in 7 days? 160. I was really thought the math teacher would just like be ready. Ah, she was listening, not doing math. I appreciate that. 168 hours in every single week. That's what you and I have. Okay, I've got 168 of them, which sounds like a lot until I start to think about what I do with mine and what you do with yours, right? So like if you're still in school or you're still one of us who has to go to a job every day, then that's like what, between 40 to 60 hours every week that is dedicated to work or to school. That's a lot of hours. Lucky us. And then I am hopeful that you and I sleep. Some of us sleep maybe 5 hours. Some of us, those retirees, I don't know, maybe you get 10 to 12 hours. It's nicely lovely. I'm so happy for you. I can only base this off my mother, who if you try to call before 1 p.m., she's just nowhere to be found. Like, it's like she's back in college. Anyhow, let's guess maybe 5 hours a night, so that's like 56. So, I'm sorry, 7 hours a night? Is that 56? Oh, good, I'm glad. Okay, so if we got 40 to 60... That's 8 hours? Oh, well, we're going to give ourselves that many. Let's say about 100 of your 160 is between work, school, or for you retirees, every retired person I've ever met says to me, I don't know how I worked. I have so many things I have to do. There it is. Okay, on top of this, you need to go grocery shopping, and you need to, I hope, like, see your family, and occasionally, like, you make phone calls for people that you love, and someone has to clean the house, and I'm assuming you have hobbies, like the Afterlife Cigar Group. How many hours a week do you all get? A lot. CJ said that's, like, this many, right? Okay, so you got a lot. You get the point. All right, now here's my question. Of all of your 168 hours every week, how many of them do you give to him? But you know it's a trick question. But I think it's how I think about my time. So, all right, Lord, I got to work. I would like sleep occasionally. I got things to do. How much do you get? And so the answer tends to be something like, well, on Sunday morning, I'll give you 2 hours. Unless you're in the band, you give them four. At least. If it's community group week, yeah, right, you get another evening. Two more hours. Your pastor is really hopeful that you spend some time praying, reading the Bible. I hope every day, but I'm not silly. So I'm going to say let's say that total, if you did a half hour every day, that's not going to be every day. Let's say it's 5 hours. And we give this to him, right? Okay. But what if it's a super busy day? Or it was a really late night? And you wake up in the morning and you go, I should read the Bible and pray, but I got a boatload. Like, that to-do list is a mile and a half long. I'm going to need that back. So Something comes up on Sunday morning. You know, your heathen family, they plan things Sunday mornings. Or there's just something you want to do, and there's a live stream. So I'm going to need those back. Do you do this? Because I'm pretty sure that's excess, right? Okay, we'll come back. Don't fall. What about this one? What if we said this was your money? Now, you can think of this marbles in any denomination you need. They can be pennies. This could be your paycheck for the two-week pay period. It can be the Social Security check that shows up. This might be your entire bank account. You know, whatever you need to help you think about this. But let's think about your money. If you're in my world, then you're still paying a mortgage or rent or something to that effect. And let me just say, that is a chunk. And they don't like when I don't pay it. You probably have utilities. And if we all looked at our PICO bill this month, it was pretty. So here we go, up to here. You need to buy groceries, because we like when we eat. There should also be, you know, maybe you got a house that you need to pay off, or a car you're paying off, rather, or you got student loans. It would be lovely to have a vacation fund. You got kids, you got grandkids that you're trying to put into college. So you're putting some money away for that, because you'd like to save. Saving's important. Occasionally, I like to put money into a retirement fund. It's not doing me any good, but I try to do it. Right? Like, I don't know about you, but my money has a home. How much of it do you give to the Lord? Like, how much is His? Some of us in the room are going to say 10%. I give 10%. The word of God in the Old Testament commanded a minimum of 10%. New Testament commands that I be generous in my giving back to the Lord through the local church. There ain't no way that generous means less than what God had commanded under the old covenant. Okay? I do. I give God, let's say, I'm not good at math. Let's say that's 10%. Some of us do, because we're able to. There was a season I didn't. But I do now. Well, so let me ask you this. Those of you who do, and you don't have to raise your hands, but for those of you who do give 10%, you're like me. Do you do anything less because you give Him what He commands? Do you go out to eat less? Do you travel less? Do you buy more less? Do you do anything less? Because if you're like me, true confessions, I don't know that I do anything less. And I'm increasingly convinced that that is the definition of giving from my excess leftovers. Because I don't feel it. Some of us don't tithe. We do not give back to the Lord 10%. For a whole variety of reasons. And I guess I would want to ask you why. Like, is it that you look at this and you say, Lord, that is ridiculous. You don't get this much. We did a tithing exercise with the kids at Kids Club this week. I gave them 100 Skittles and said, they're all mine. I give them to you. All I ask is that you give me back 10%. You can eat the Skittles, you can save the Skittles, you can give them to a friend. I don't care what you do with the 90, you just gotta give me back 10. And we handed them out, and the kids went, yay! And then I told them what they were gonna do, and one of the children, I thought she was gonna deck me. She said, no! I said, they're mine, and she said, not now. I was like, yes, sweetheart, that is how we feel about our money. So some of us, we don't do it because that's our attitude, right? Like, it's mine. God, you're ridiculous. Or some of us say, well, I would like to, but did you see my PICO bill? I'm going to need that back. I got building projects at the house. Things have come up. I need it back. Do you get my point? See, I am pretty convinced that we could do that about a whole bunch of topics. We could talk about our homes. We could talk about our skills, the gifts that God's given us. We could talk about the relationships that we have. My guess is that for many of us, I've said all of us in some area, but many of us in most areas, the truth of the matter is we give God our excess time, what I have left over, and I'm going to take everything else back. I give Him my excess money for His kingdom and His glory. I give the excess parts of my life. But if it pinches, if it's more than leftover, I'm keeping that. Jesus brought the disciples over and He said, look at that woman. She's not giving out of excess. She's not giving leftovers. She gave everything, her entire life. And I'm pretty sure He brought them over and said, look at her. Because Jesus was trying to say to them, that woman is doing exactly, she believes the truth that he had taught the disciples earlier that same day. See, I think the lady understood, that widow understood something that I struggle to do more than just say. She knew who she belonged to. The passage that Connie read for us from the beginning of earlier in Mark chapter 12, verse 13, Jesus is there in the temple, and two groups of people come to him. Well, the Herodians, which just means people that loved King Herod, they were pro-Rome, and the Pharisees, who did not love King Herod and were not pro-Rome. But you know, a common enemy will make strange bedfellows. So the Pharisees and the Herodians come, and basically they're just trying to trap Jesus, okay? That's their whole goal. So they come up to him, and they flatter him, and they don't really mean it. And then they ask this question. They say, is it right to give taxes or to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay or shouldn't we pay? And the little deceptive question that they're asking is about a very particular tax, right? This particular tax, think like a head tax. The way it worked, because Judah at the time was under Roman oppression, Roman authority, the head tax was one denarius for every Jewish male of a certain age and up. And it basically, it was just a denarius. It was one day's wage. It wasn't a whole ton. And it really was just a way of saying, I'm owned by Rome. And it was this constant remembrance that Rome was in charge and you weren't actually free. So when they ask Jesus this question, they're trying to trap him, right? Because if he says, yep, pay your taxes, give it to Caesar, go ahead, then all of the Jewish males who are considering following him are going to be ticked off. They're like, dude, we do not like Rome. And if he says, no, don't pay them, then soldiers will be appearing very soon. Either way, his enemies win. But Jesus is smarter than them. So Jesus asks a question, and he says, okay, let's not talk about this. Go find a denarius and show it to me. And so they do. They go, they find, and this is a picture of a denarius. No collector's given me one yet, so I had to get a picture off the internet. And here's a picture of it. And he asks them a question. He says, whose image and inscription is on that denarius? And he trapped them, because they can't answer any other way. He says, whose picture's on it? And they went, Caesar's, because it is. The one on the front there, that is Augustus Tiberius. His face is literally stamped on the coin. You know why? Because it belonged to him. In Rome, the way the money worked was it was his, literally his money. It was his gold. It was his silver. It was his whatever. And they stamp his face on it, and then out would go the money for you to use. It literally belongs to this guy. And so the front of it says, Augustus Tiberius, son of the divine Augustus. Yeah, son of God. That's a statement that Jesus is going to speak against later on. The back says, high priest. It's got his face on it. Now, here's the kicker. When the people came to Jesus and they said, should we, my English translation says, should we pay the tax? What the Greek literally says is, should we give the tax? It's like they come to Jesus and they said, so it's my denarius, mine. I earned it. I worked for it. It's mine. Should I give it like it's a gift to Caesar? Which is kind of how I look at my money and my time. It's definitely how I look at my money when Uncle Sam shows up. Should I give it to him? Jesus, after showing it to them, changes the verb. And what Jesus says, I've memorized it in the KJV, was render to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. Give back to Caesar what was always his. The verb that Jesus uses is one from accounting. So they came and they said, should we give it what's mine? Should I give it to him? And he says, well, it was never yours. You need to give back to Caesar what belonged to Caesar. So yeah, give him his tax. But give back to God what belongs to him. See, the Bible tells me that you and I are made in the image of God. He's literally stamped on us. We belong to him. We were created in his image and created by him. Scripture says that every hour and minute and second And breath that I have, he gave me. They're his. Scripture also says that every single thing in this world, every resource that I am given, that every good and perfect gift comes not from my hard work, but from the one who gives the gifts. They're his. All of it. So go back to the woman. I think Jesus brought the disciples over because he said this and they went, yeah, you tricked them, Jesus. And he went, no, this is about you. Give back to God what belongs to God. The reason why I give God from my excess is I think it's mine. So I can take it back anytime I want. In a couple weeks, we're going to start talking about, like next week, we are literally, I shouldn't tell you this, you won't come back. Next week, we're going to talk about nitty-gritty. What does it look like to give your time? What does it look like to give your treasure? Give your talent. Say, they were never mine to begin with, and so, Lord, I offer them to you. But this week, maybe we just have to start here with this idea that you and I like to give excess of things that were never ours to begin with. So let's sum this up, shall we? Jesus wants your everything, guys, not your excess. That means that the one who says, you are made in my image, everything you have belongs to you, the one who has given you 168 hours this week, they belong to him. So he's not interested in a couple little things that you want to throw his direction. He actually wants it all. I bet that sounded pretty on the live stream. Genuinely wants it all. He wants all your time, and he wants all my time. Now listen, to say to the Lord, I present as an offering all of this time, I give back to you what has always been yours, does not mean that the Lord is saying, I need you to spend every waking hour on your knees praying or reading the Bible. It does mean you should pray and read the Bible, but it means that you then get up and you go to work as someone who says, God, the hours that I'm here are yours. Use them to your glory. You get up and you run your errands and you say, all of my time is yours. Now that might mean that there's some stuff that you have to look at and say, so I'm going to stop doing that. It's a waste of his time. But guys, it means things like go to bed. Get to the end of the day and say the to-do list is too long and I'm too stressed. And you say, and none of it's mine anyhow. So I'm going to rest because the king is on his throne. And I can go to sleep. This week, I think maybe we should sit with this sentence. You and I need to do an actual honest inventory. How many areas in your life do you give God excess, leftovers? Because it makes you too uncomfortable to give him everything. But some of us also have to remember one little detail here. He does want your everything, not your excess. And he wants your everything even if you think it's insignificant. The truth is, some of us are sitting here going, listen, if you'd asked me this 40 years ago, I would have said that giving to God my income, because I had more back then, was significant. But now, or if you'd asked me in this other season of life when I actually feel like I had time to commit to the Lord, but today, or I used to be able to, and now I can't. He doesn't care. The issue is not whether you and I think what we have to offer him is a significant enough amount. It doesn't matter if you're looking at this going, well, those are each marble's a penny or each marble's a gold bar. All he wants is all of it. He's not asking you to evaluate it. Because when you give it to him, he has this really amazing, funny way of taking the insignificant offering, like a widow's two lepta. You still know her story. He can take what's incredibly insignificant in his kingdom. You know, it turns out to be enough. It's kind of like two sardine sandwiches that some little boy gave him one day that fed 5,000 people. If that kid had said, it's insignificant, what would be different? He wants your everything, not your excess. He wants your everything, even if you think it's insignificant. And if this is stressing you out, I need you to remember something. The one who is asking for it is the one who did what that widow did. She figuratively gave her life, gave everything, poured it out for her father. But Jesus literally did that. And he took all his time, all his resources, all his power. He took his whole life. And on a cross, offered every bit of it. And the one who is asking you to trust him, because this is really about trust, to trust him with all your time or all of your money or all of you, is the one who laid his entire life down for you. He can be trusted because he did way more than he's ever going to ask you and I to do. As the band's coming forward and we're preparing to come pray, I'm going to invite you and I to treat this like, well, your time to come to the altar. If you need to come before Jesus today and you need to say, I've been giving you my excess, and you need to confess that, then do it. If you want to come today and say, Lord, I'm scared, but I'm ready, then offer yourself to him, because he's very, very, very interested in everything. He wants your whole life. Let's pray. Jesus, I am incredibly grateful that you don't ever give me excess grace or your leftover mercy or the throwaways of your love, but that you have chosen instead to give us everything. I ask for myself and then for all of my brothers and sisters, Lord, that you would convict us where we struggle to trust you. Convict us where we don't want to hear that we are giving back what is always yours. We far prefer to say, no, I give you a gift. Here it is, this tiny bit. Lord, as you convict us that all of us belongs to you, then would you invite us to be a people who more and more, instead of giving of excess, giving you our leftovers, are living from the place, Lord, of saying, I give you everything. Father, every time the evil one says that our everything is too insignificant, I pray that you would silence his lies and invite us to know that you're the God who says you genuinely want us. And Lord, when we get too scared to do it, may we see you on a cross and know that the one who asks for everything is the one who's already given it. Thanks for loving us, Jesus. We pray these things in your name, and all God's people said.
Amen.
Amen.